Pleased to have Jutho Hagman from Ghent University, who will be talking about rigorous free fermion entanglement renormalization from wavelets.
Thank you for the introduction, and also I would like to thank Stephen for putting together this nice workshop and for giving me the opportunity to present this recent work here, which was in collaboration with Brian, who's also here and will maybe also refer to part of this in his talk tomorrow, and then with Michael Walter, Jordan Kotler, Glenn Evemley, and Volker Scholz. So it's about a recent paper, but actually I decided after hearing yesterday's talk that I have this introduction about tensor networks and their application to quantum field theories. And I would actually make this rather long and in order to connect to some of the things that you heard yesterday, especially during the morning session. And so this is maybe at the expense of having a bit less time to go through the rest of the talk, so we'll see how fast time goes. So for those of you who don't know tensor networks, what they are, if you think about a pure quantum state of a many-body system, and you represent it with respect to some tensor quadratic basis, then the wave function is captured by these coefficients, which one typically thinks of as being a huge vector, or equivalently as being a tensor, which you will use this diagrammatic notation, this kind of graphical notation, where a tensor we represent it as a box with legs attached to it, and every leg represents an index, so it can take values in whatever Hilbert space is associated with that index. And then simple examples of this diagrammatic notation is you have a vector, an object with a single index, a matrix, and then whatever you connect indices between two of these objects, it means a tensor convection, or in this simple case, a matrix product. A bit more involved example would be this graphical representation of the Young-Baxter equation, where this would be some kind of R tensor which implements a braid. And what do we use this for? Well, this high-rank tensor that represents a quantum many-body state, we will try to find some kind of decomposition of it in terms of tensors of lower rank, which therefore provide a more efficient description. And this is usually, used as a kind of variational ansatz. So these are different variational families. They don't capture all the states in the Hilbert space, but it turns out that these are usually very good ansatzes for low energy states of local Hamiltonians. And this is motivated by the structure of entanglement that is known in these states, namely the area law of entanglement entropy. And so you have these different families corresponding to the underlying lattice structure of the quantum many-body system. So matrix product states are definitely the most well-known or the most successful from a numerical point of view for one-dimensional lattice systems. And then their natural generalization to higher dimensions would be these projected entangled pair states, formulated by Verstappen and Sirac. The matrix product states, they actually have a long history in physics. They, if you look carefully, go back to the work of Baxter, but then reappeared in the context of DMRG, reappeared in mathematical physics under the name of finitely correlated states. So they appeared several times. And then there is this MIRA, this multiscale entanglement renormalization ansatz of Giffrey-Vidal, that I will be talking about in the main part of this talk. And so as I said, these are used for classical simulation, really putting things on current day classical computers and doing numerical simulations. They can actually also be used to put bounds on classical complexity scaling. So the first result in that direction was Hastings, who indeed proved that for one-dimensional systems with a gap, in order to represent it up to a certain the quantum state up to a certain error with the matrix product state, you only need polynomial scaling in the bond dimension, and the bond dimension being these inner indices here which are contracted over. So these are some kind of virtual degrees of freedom, virtual indices that by which you describe your state and truly the way we think of them is as representing kind of the entanglement degrees of freedom. And then this work has more recently been refined by people like Arad, Kitaev, Landa, Fazirani, Vidic. And Are there any other comments? I think the only thing is indeed, so it's really the entanglement structure. So if you look carefully, it's actually not just area law of entanglement. Entropy is just not enough to actually get, for example, to matrix product states. You need area law for any entropies more generally. And so it's really this entanglement structure more generally, which is very important. And this is also what Mira will be about. But before going into this, let me show some of some other results about tensor networks and quantum field theory. So using these as variational methods, you can just try to apply them to lattice gauge theories, but then not in the way that Monte Carlo people would do it, because indeed, like we heard yesterday, we want to work in a Hamiltonian framework if we work with quantum states. So we only discretize real space, not time. And then you can use, for example, these matrix product states for 1+1 dimensional quantum field theories. An example that has been studied, has received a lot of attention the last few years is the Swinger model, about which we also heard yesterday in the talk of Benet Resnik, which is basically 1+1 dimensional QED, which is a bit broken in the sense that in one dimension there are no actual dynamic photons, there are no massless degrees of freedom in the system. Nevertheless, it's already an interesting testbed. It has confinement, of course, for the trivial reason that even classical electromagnetism in 1D would have a linearly increasing potential. It has been studied first, actually, by DMRG already in 2002 by Byrnes, who was really very early to the scene, because then all the more recent works are, I think, starting 2014 or so. So Boye Byrnes was a PhD student in the group in Ghent. Marie-Carmen Manuls is in the group of Ignacio Chirac, and then there's also the group of Montangero, who all more or less simultaneously did several studies using these ideas of tensor networks applied to mostly the Swinger model. Here I just show one result where basically you put, so it's really full QED, including the dynamical fermions. Where you just put two heavy fermions, two heavy quarks at a certain distance. And then what is plotted here is basically the potential energy or the excess energy of putting these fermions there, putting these test charges there. And what you see here is basically the concept of string breaking. But what we use is not necessarily integer charges, so fractional charges. And then string breaking cannot, well, what you see is basically the concept of partial string breaking. And to the best of our knowledge, this was actually, had not been studied with Monte Carlo. Turns out to be more difficult, apparently. So you nicely see that if you take like an integer charge, like charge one, then indeed, after some time, the potential doesn't increase anymore, remains constant. So there, the string is broken completely. But for most of the other charges which are listed here, they're fractional, and you will still see that the string breaking cannot be completed, and so the potential will still increase as a function of distance. Then you can actually look at basically the charge distribution of basically the screening charges, so the light fermions that are created out of the vacuum to compensate for this thing. Again, as a function of distance, so this is for different distances, the different colors that you see here. And corresponding to this, also the value of the electric field. So if the two test charges are very close together, then basically there is a very strong electric field just in between them. This is this tiny purple dot that you might see here. And then if you pull them farther apart, then light fermions are created out of the vacuum. And these kind of lower the electric field in between them. And the nice thing about, of course, these tensor networks is that you're not only restricted to like physical observables that you can easily measure, but also to things like entanglement entropy. So here is a corresponding bipartite entanglement, so as a function of where you make your cut, just between left and the right half. And it's only the excess entanglement, so that you get on top of the entanglement that's already in the vacuum without probing charges. And you see these different spikes appearing here, and somehow these seem indeed to be related to the number of screening charges that have been created. So this is really the case where there have been where four screening charges have been created. So this was for this test charge of 4.5. So that's well, a nice application. Another thing where tensor networks might be beneficial over traditional Monte Carlo results is the fact that they can indeed do real-time evolution, although they're also limited in that sense. Because in real-time evolution, one expects entanglement to grow, and therefore this will put a natural cutoff on the time that you can reach. But this is just an example simulation for a global quench where you put some kind of background electric field. Well, you compute the ground states in the presence of a background electric field, and then you just let it evolve with the Hamiltonian without a background electric field. And you look at how the electric field will vary over time, how basically the number of fermions will evolve over time. And what these dotted lines represent is, so this is evolution with a time-independent Hamiltonian. So you expect there is no integrability, so you expect thermalization to happen. And these dotted lines are estimates for what the thermal value of, or basically the equilibrium value of a thermal state which has the same energy as that initial state, what it would be. So you see that for the times that we were able to reach with these simulations, we certainly have not thermalized yet, but it seems to be going in the right direction. So this is all 1D. The progress to 2+1 dimensional systems and 3+1 dimensional systems seems more challenging, but there are certainly first explorations by people like Luca Tagliacozzi, Zohar, again in the group of Ignacio Sirac. And so this is certainly looking like a very promising direction in which this field will evolve. I have here this quantum field theory one, because this is more or less a traditional approach or the expected approach where indeed you discretize your field theory in order to be able to simulate it on your classical computer. And as you heard yesterday, also possibly on a quantum computer. Recently, there have also been proposals for actually tensor networks that work directly with continuous systems. The first one was this proposal of a continuous matrix product state by Verstaten and Sirac. What is shown here is just, well, very early simulation, also dating back to those, to like 2011 or something, of some other famous quantum field theory in 1D, the Grossen-Veur model, which is interesting for other reasons. It's not a gauge theory, it's pure fermions interacting with each other. The interesting features of this model is that it has asymptotic freedom, like UCD, and it has a kind of chiral symmetry breaking. It's not the full continuous chiral symmetry, because you can anyway not break continuous symmetry in 1+1, but it has a discrete version of chiral symmetry, and this is broken, and so there is kind of dynamical mass generation. There is a dimensional transmutation in the sense that this model doesn't have a dimensionful parameter, unlike the Swinger model. And still you get a mass scale arising automatically, which is much smaller than the cutoff scale. So these are features that are indeed reminiscent of what also happens in QCD. And so here I just plot basically the expectation value of the chiral condensates for different values of the interaction parameter and for different bond dimensions of this continuous MPS, which are, if you're familiar with MPS or DMRG simulations, they are pretty low, and that's indeed because these continuous matrix product states there, they haven't been fully developed yet to the same extent, so the algorithms are still a bit less stable. Well, there's definitely room for improvement in that direction, and so that's certainly something that I hope to see advance in the near future. There's also a continuous version of Mira. I'm going to say even less about this, in the sense that as a variational black box tool, there's basically nothing that you can do with them so far, in the sense that the only concrete proposal so far is for, well, I mean, the proposal can be, you can write it down for general theories, but to actually compute with it, it's really an analytical computation, and so far it's only been illustrated with Gaussian states. Nevertheless, this has already proven to be an interesting tool in another direction, namely to investigate the relation between MIRA and holography, the ADS-CFT. So especially Takaya Nagi has done a lot of work on this. Yes. Yes. For both continuous MPS and continuous MIRA, it's about the real space which becomes continuous. So really have an infinite number of degrees of freedom in finite volume. No. We use the fact that because it's a translation invariant system, you can actually capture an infinite system in the continuum with just a fine, I mean, the way the CMPS parameterization of states works, you can just parameterize the translation invariant system in the thermodynamic limit with just a finite number of parameters without a need for discretizing, without a need for finite volume. So that's another more technical advantage of tensor networks over Monte Carlo, that they can truly work in the thermodynamic limit. They're, of course, limited by basically the entanglement cutoff. So there is some natural correlation length appearing. This can still be a useful advantage in the sense that, for example, you can create excited states and basically have full momentum resolution in plotting the spectrum of excited states. So this slide basically is here more or less as an advertisement, because these are directions that I certainly would like to see advance in the next few years and plan to work on myself. And we actually also have positions available for people interested in working on this. So this is this bond dimension. So in the MPS case, it's basically the dimension of the vector space, of the Hilbert space, of these virtual degrees of freedom. And this is kind of a refinement parameter. The larger you make this bond dimension, the more states in your Hilbert, in your physical Hilbert space that you can target. But of course, the higher the computational cost becomes. So if d equals 1, it's just a product state, I mean field ansatz. And then as you increase D, you get more and more entanglement, and you get closer and closer to the exact state. Okay, so that's kind of the general introduction that I probably spent like half of the time on. So let me now come to the main topic of my talk. But first giving another kind of introduction to the concept of MIRA, renormalization, and how it's related to wavelets. So this multiscale entanglement renormalization ansatz of Giffre-Vidal was another kind of tensor network aimed at targeting those kind of systems for which MPS are actually less suited, namely those without a mass gap. So which have diverging correlation length, which have power law decay of correlations. And it's inspired by a renormalization. So it's a kind of renormalization group transformation at the level of the quantum state. So you can read this this picture here. So what you need to know to read this picture is basically all these blocks here are unitary matrices from two inputs, well, like two qubits or two whatever local Hilbert space you have, to two outputs. And then this is one layer of the MIRA, and then essentially one of the two outputs coming out of every of these unitaries is not touched upon anymore. So this line just goes through, it's not acted upon by these higher layers. So these higher layers then only act on like half of the original degrees of freedom. And what you try to do is, if you read it from bottom to top, is if you would have a quantum state, you would like, so since these are unitaries, this is really a quantum circuit, and every layer is just a finite depth quantum circuit. And with this finite depth quantum circuit, what you try to do is more or less starting from a given quantum state, disentangle half of the degrees of freedom, so that ideally, the output in the end would actually be this completely disentangled state of all zeros. Of course, the way it's used is as a variational ansatz, where basically this is your ansatz for how a quantum state should look like of a critical system. And then you try to find unitaries that indeed actually prepare your state, and doing so, you actually have created a quantum circuit that prepares, for example, the ground state of a well, a CFT, or at least a lattice model for which the low energy description could be a CFT. So typically it's not down like this. It's basically all these Ancila states are brought down to the place where they emerge here, and you get basically unitaries and isometries. But this is an equivalent description, and given this audience, I thought it was more useful. This is actually also how it was, I think, in the first paper of Giffrey-Vidal. I think I already mentioned indeed that this variational ansatz captures basically the phenomenology that you expect of critical systems. So power law decay of correlations, it supports logarithmic violations of error laws, at least in one dimension. And this is something I'm also going to get back to. And there are conjectures relations between MIRA and holography, and this is thanks also to Brian, who I think was the first to point out possible connections there, but these have then been refined later on. Another side note, I presented this as a renormalization group transformation of quantum states. You can actually also start from a path integral or kind of imaginary time evolution that would prepare your state starting from any given initial state, and perform some kind of renormalization procedure, which is known as tensor network renormalization, at the level of the partition function. So this is tensor network representation of partition functions. How do you get to this, for example, by indeed doing this imaginary time evolution again in a Hamiltonian framework and with operators, and then using, for example, these total decompositions and recombining them. You would get this kind of structure where every layer represents a small step dt of imaginary time evolution. And now you can try to look for, again, some kind of unitary operators and isometries, which allow you to compress basically four of those individual tensors into single one. And then there are some intermediate steps which I kind of left out. So it's not that one of these will immediately like coarse grain your partition function by a factor of two. It's actually by a factor of square root of two. You would get another one if you plug this in everywhere. All these disentanglers will drop out. They will cancel with the neighboring one. You will end up with this. You get something which you can represent as an other tensor. You do this a second time. And so after doing this twice, what you end up with is something like this, so some kind of coarse-grained partition function, and then if only the bonds here at the bottom were open, and so all the rest basically extends towards infinity, you would get a first layer of unitaries and isometries. And then you repeat this procedure a second time, and you repeat it, third time. And so basically what is done here is, the reason that I thought it was worthwhile mentioning this, yesterday it was mentioned indeed that classical simulation, Monte Carlo simulations, they work with imaginary time. Quantum computing typically tries to simulate real-time evolution. Well, here is actually a procedure to give an imaginary time evolution to actually replace it by a unitary quantum circuit, which has the same entangling effect as the original non-unitary evolution. This is also relevant in the context, for example, these partition functions could also be just typical classical stat-mech partition functions. And then it's kind of unnatural or unexpected that you get something like unitary operators, which can be even complex or at least will have negative numbers and everything in there. If you want to coarse grain a classical partition function, you might want to be interested in preserving positivity of your Boltzmann weights. And so there is actually some kind of alternative way of implementing this tensor network renormalization using ideas from machine learning or from basically the concept of non-negative matrix factorization, so that you preserve positivity, and which basically allows you to actually construct a flow of renormalized, of coarse grained classical Hamiltonians. Which was performed by another student in our group. Then wavelets. Being a Belgian, I'm morally obliged to show Dobichy, who is probably one of our most famous mathematicians. So I hope everybody has at least heard of wavelets. You might have seen these kind of pictures, these kind of transformations, where basically, well, now it's two dimensions, of course, so but in both directions, you kind of coarse grain by a scale of two, and then there's some kind of high energy features or high small length scale features and some kind of coarse grained image, and then you will keep on applying the same transformation again only to this coarse grained output. This is, if you see wavelets, if you see Mira, there is certainly some an analogy there. And indeed this was worked out, I mean the exact relationship was worked out in detail by Glenn Evenbly and Steve White in this recent paper, where they show that indeed if you restrict to the case of free fermions, so if you have a free fermion Mira, meaning that the unitaries are basically generated by quadratic operators and that fermion number is preserved, then this actually implements a kind of wavelet transformation if you look at the single particle level. So if you just take one layer of the Mira circuit and you put basically all, if every link is just a single fermionic mode and you make all of them empty except for one of them, then in the output here, you will just have a fermion in some kind of state which is living on those four sites. And you can define another state on four sites, and these would naturally be orthogonal, and then but also with all the shifted versions. And this is exactly what also the kind of information that you need to implement the wavelet transform. And since this was always the first one that I actually let continue in the Mira network, and the second one which was immediately topped off, we could identify those with the scaling coefficients of a wavelet transform and those with the wavelet coefficients. And vice versa, now in given a wavelet transform, you can construct like a second quantized version of it by just finding the kind of unitary circuit. And this was actually addressed in another paper by the same people. And this actually also provides a new way of constructing or thinking about wavelet transforms. So if you want to represent the ground state of a free fermion Hamiltonian, what's the usual way of doing it? Well, you diagonalize a single particle Hamiltonian and you fill all the negative energy modes. But actually the eigenstates of the Hamiltonian are not that relevant. It's only the combined subspace of all the negative energy eigenstates, but not the individual eigenstates, which for a translation invariant system would be momentum eigenstates and would be completely delocalized. So if you can find another set of modes which basically span the same space, namely this Fermi or Dirac-C, and you will end up at the same state. So you can basically perform basis transformations in the filled space, in the negative energy space, and in the positive energy space simultaneously. Or with these wavelets, what we can try to do is construct the wavelet outputs in such a way that they're completely supported in either the positive or the negative energy subspace, because then we can disentangle them. If we know that a wavelet output here will actually live completely in the positive energy subspace, well, then put a zero here. If it's in the negative energy eigenspace, then we fill it, then we put a one there. So that's the challenge, try to construct wavelets which are compactly supported sequences such that they're completely supported in either positive or negative energy subspace of a Hamiltonian. And so then let us finally get to some formulas. The first example would be 1 plus 1 Dirac fermions. Again, using the staggered formulation, but where we actually still keep the 2 degrees of freedom on a single site. In momentum space, that kind of single that description would look like this, where here is your single particle Hamiltonian in the momentum space. And if you would usually diagonalize this, you would, for example, write down these eigenstates. These ones are not normalized here. And you would find these two energies, sine of k over 2 and minus sine of k over 2. This would be the right mover and the left mover. But they actually don't have a definite energy. This one has positive energy for positive k and negative energy for negative k and vice versa. So we actually want to work with the basis which clearly distinguishes between the negative energies and the positive energies, the ones that we want to fill, the ones that we want to leave empty. And so then the proper eigenvectors as a function of momentum look like these two columns here. And we can write this as this diagonal matrix times Hadamard. Now if we want to implement or if you want to construct kind of wavelet transform which the wavelets will be properly supported in subspace of either one of those two. The way to do it is to, since we actually anyway have two modes, two fermions per link, we actually need a pair of wavelet transforms, one that will act on the first mode, one that will act on the second mode. And we want a pair of wavelets so that basically the two wavelet filters, so here they're labeled GW and HW, they actually have equal magnitude, but they differ by a relative phase, which is exactly this one. And then using the theory of wavelets, you can work out if you have a pair of wavelet sequences that has this relative phase, and the corresponding scaling sequences should actually just have this simple phase difference, which is just, well, in real space, it would actually correspond to a half shift. But of course, well, side note is that if indeed you find two scaling filters which have this relative phase difference, then it turns out that not only the first level wavelet will have this one, but then also if you keep repeating your wavelet transform, also the wavelets that you get from the higher levels, they will actually all have this desired phase difference. So this means in Mira language that the kind of circuit that you use on the second layer and the third layer, you can always use the same one. So you will actually get a scale invariant Mira, which is what you expect since we're looking at massless theory at Dirac fermions with no mass. So the challenge is to construct a pair of wavelets or scaling filters which have this phase difference. And it's clear that you will not be able to find an exact solution to this problem because this function is of course discontinuous at the edge of the Brillouin zone. The Brillouin zone is in the anti-circle, so the value at plus pi and minus pi doesn't match, so there is a discontinuity there. And with filters of finite support, we will not be able to capture this exactly, but of course we can try to find an approximation. And luckily, this actually has already been studied or solved in the wavelet literature by a person called Selesnik. And so he constructs, indeed, family of solutions parameterized by two integers k and l, such that so you have a pair of scaling sequences and corresponding wavelet sequences, which have exactly equal magnitude. And they differ by a phase, and this phase approximates the half shift, but of course is still limited by the constraints of being finitely supported in real space, so it's a continuous function. What I plot here is not the scaling functions, but the wavelet functions, where the discontinuity would be at momentum zero. So I still have to explain what these k and l are. So here you just see the lines. The dotted line is basically the exact phase difference that you want to approximate. This is for the wavelets of the first level, the second level, the third level. Shows the phase difference between these two wavelet sequences. And then the surfaces, the filled surfaces, basically represent the corresponding norm of these wavelets. So what you see, the level one wavelet follows this line perfectly, and then of course it deviates around momentum zero to become nicely continuous. But that's okay because it's anyway only supported at high frequencies, at high momenta. It basically has vanishing support around momentum zero. And so this is where these two integers come into play. K is basically something that you get always, that in a lot of wavelet families you see up here, it's kind of a moment condition. And this basically indeed tells you how strongly the support around momentum zero is suppressed for the wavelets. And then L has to do with indeed how well do you approximate this half shift delay. And by combining this, so there will always be some kind of deviation around momentum zero, but by then also increasing K, you can actually make the wavelet sequence have vanishing support in this region. Yes? This is indeed, yeah, so it has been more clear. This is the Fourier transform of the wavelet, in this case scaling sequences. What is plotted here is the phase difference between the Fourier transform of the wavelet sequences and the absolute value of that Fourier transform. So the surfaces are the absolute value of the Fourier transformed wavelet sequence, and the lines are the the phase difference. So they have equal magnitude, so that's why I only plot one of the two norms. And then you can look at the level two wavelet, which is this orange curve. So it deviates not only at momentum zero, but also at momentum pi, but that's actually also not supported around momentum pi, so that's again okay. And so with these wavelets then, constructing corresponding unitary circuits would actually implement exactly these wavelet and scaling sequences, you can approximately represent the ground state of these Dirac fermions. Another thing I want to mention is Fermi surfaces in 2D and higher D. These are known to have also in higher dimensions logarithmic violations of the error law of entanglement. And this is something that you cannot capture with the usual two-dimensional mirror. There is a proposal by Glenn FMD and Giffrey Vidal, mentioned on the next slide. Some kind of more general unitary circuit structure which does capture these kind of logarithmic violations. So let us first look at this problem. So this is just actually, so I'm now actually switching to non-relativistic fermions. Of course, the concept of Fermi surfaces also is relevant in relativistic systems. If you have quark gluon plasmas or heavy ion reactions. 1D non-relativistic fermions, they actually just map to these Dirac fermions. In 2D, what you can also construct some kind of similar mapping. So you block sides, but you actually block them diagonally. So you block A and B sublattices. And you get this kind of single particle Hamiltonian, which you can diagonalize with this unitary transformation. And it's again this Hadamard. And then basically the same signs, the same phase structures in the two directions independently. So what you want to do is kind of clear. You want to implement an independent wavelet transform in the x direction and the y direction. But of course, if you do this in two dimensions, you will not only get the wavelet outputs, which you can then immediately disentangle. So wavelet x, wavelet I, and scaling x, scaling I, which you will let continue to the next layer. You will also get the mixed terms, the scaling in x, wavelet in y. And so what do you do with those? This is, we didn't manage to actually draw a three-dimensional quantum circuit showing this. So this is a schematic representation. Well, this is related to indeed blocking these two sublattices. Then you implement these independent wavelet transforms in X and Y. And then you get these four different types of outputs. Wavelet, you can immediately disentangle if you also implement this Hadamard on top of it. And then scaling in X, wavelet, and Y. Well, this means that in the y direction it's already okay, but then you still want to implement further wavelet transforms only in the x direction. So you get, on this output, it goes through and you get a kind of tensor product of one-dimensional wavelet transforms on top of this. The same for the other mixed term, and then scaling output actually goes through and repeats itself. So you indeed get some kind of branching structure. These are basically the energy levels of the renormalized Hamiltonians in this channel and in those channels. At the bottom here is basically the phase structure of the eigenvalues of these Hamiltonians. So you see it's indeed, the phase structure is purely one-dimensional. So this indeed means that you can implement it with this unitary circuits, which are tensor products in one direction. And then, so this is, indeed fits within a general concept that was introduced by Glenn and Giffrey called branching mirror. But the actual concrete branching mirror that they had in mind to target Fermi surfaces in 2D was actually slightly different. And I will show it on the next slide. And I think this one is actually more, fits better with the spirit of RG for Fermi surfaces. This was, for example, described in this nice paper by Shankar. So where indeed, you see that 2D Fermi surface, you interpret it as kind of a collection of one-dimensional chiral fermions. So this is just, skip this. This is just indeed to show that this captures the correct entanglement and that indeed the original proposal had a kind of different branching structure. And just state this rigorous approximation result that I wanted to get to. Which is that given, basically our basic assumption is that these wavelet solutions exist with some error. We didn't try to prove this. So they have they have this exact phase difference. The error with respect to this exact phase difference is smaller than epsilon, and this can be either because the theta is very close to k over 2, or just the norm of these two filters individually is very small. So here you see as a function of k and l how indeed this epsilon goes down. There is another constant which is related to the corresponding father wavelet, so the continuum function that you get out of this wavelet transform. Given this information, defining general correlation functions of n annihilation operators, n creation operators, and superpositions of states, so not restricted to single sites. It turns out that you can bound the difference between the expectation values, so the correlation function that you get from the exact vacuum and that of the mirror solution using those wavelets, can be bounded by this expression here. What is in here? So the square root of the number of operators that you would want to put in your correlator. This 2 to the minus L. L is basically the number of layers in your mirror. So actually, in scalar invariant setting in numerics, you can actually push this L to infinity. So then this first term would drop. But you still have the second term, of course, which is controlled by the error in your wavelet approximation. And some constants also related to the support of these functions. So this is, I think, the final result. So here indeed we have an actual strict bound on we are not bounding the difference between the corresponding states in the thermodynamic limits. They would anyway be orthogonal, as is well known in any case. But for correlation, if your only goal is to approximate correlation functions, you can actually get a very, very small bound on the difference. And this is some actual practical simulation results from using those wavelets. So let me skip this and get to the outlook. So the wavelet transform, or using wavelets to construct mirrors for free fermion theories, we can try to extend it to also include massive theories. Or maybe to add pairing terms so that you no longer have fermion number conservation, but just fermion parity conservation. In that case, what you want to implement is orthogonal transformations within the set of Majorana operators instead of unitary transformations in the set of creation and annihilation operators. And then more interesting prospects is looking at direct cones and topological insulators and trying to understand what the relevance is of being able to construct these exact quantum circuits for preparing ground states of interacting theories. For example, if they would have asymptotic freedom, then you might expect that this wavelet solution is good to put in the basically in the high frequency, so these are actually the lowest levels in your mirror, that you could just still use the free solution there and then only need to modify the layers corresponding to infrared behavior. And that's it. So any questions?